بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين والصفوة المخلصة من أصحابه الميامين ومن تبعهم بإحسان وإيمان إلى يوم الدين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي قال تعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأنزلنا إليك الذكر لتبين للناس ما نزل إليهم ولعلهم يتفكرون صدق الله العلي العظيم There is a common question by many people who ask that if we have this book, the Holy Quran, and it is the revelation of God to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then why do we need the Hadith? Why is the Hadith? Why should we hold fast to the Hadith and narrate the Hadith and treat the Hadith as something sacred, something important? We have the Quran. And Allah says about the Quran, tibyanan li kulli shay. Tibyan, it means to elucidate, to explain everything thoroughly has been explained in the Quran. So why do we really need the Hadith? Because in the Hadith, when we come to the Hadith, there are many fabrications, falsifications, the Hadith which is a true, the Hadith which is not a true, unreliable, da'if, you know, this or that. So why do we need the Hadith? And there is a lot of people who say this, and not only now, you hear this now more often, but this used to be the cliche from the beginning of Islam, actually from the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Had people who objected to the Hadith. The son of the second caliph, Abdullah, the son of Umar ibn Khattab, he said, whenever the Prophet says something, I will get a pen and paper and write it down. Everything the Prophet says. So Quraysh told me, and this Hadith is narrated by many important books in the Sunni tradition, Sunan Abi Dawood, Sunan al-Darimi, Musnad al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and many others. They narrate this story. So Quraysh, it means the people in Medina, the people in Medina, he refers to them as Quraysh, the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet, who came with him from Mecca to Medina. They said to him, Abdullah, why do you write everything the Prophet says? Because the Prophet is a human being, and sometimes he makes mistakes. So don't write everything the Prophet says. He's a human being. So he says, I was really worried. I came to the Prophet, I said, Ya Rasulallah, those people, they tell me, don't write everything the Prophet says, because you are a human being, and sometimes you make mistakes and errors. So the Prophet said to him, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Uktub, don't worry about what they say. Uktub. فَوَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ مَا خَرَجَ مِنْهُ إِلَّا حَقٍّ. By the Lord who controls my life, nothing comes out of my mouth but truth. حَقٍّ. Truth. So don't worry. Yes, I am a human being. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ. Allah says to Quraysh, to the Arabs in Mecca and Medina, this is in Mecca, مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ. Your sahib, your leader, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did not go wrong. مَا ظَلَّ صَاحِبْ from ضَلَالَهِ. He did not go wrong. He was not misguided. He knows what he is talking about. مَا ظَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى غَوَى from غِوَايَة, which is deviation. He never deviated from the truth, from the straight path.
إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى.
Things that he's telling you are revelations revealed to him.
إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى.
Even when he gets angry, hawa means desire, emotions. Sometimes, you see ourselves when we get angry? Sometimes we say things that we regret. 5 minutes later, we regret. Because we were angry. We could not control our speech. We say things, something bad to people who are around us, and then after that, oops, what did I say? That's not good. The Prophet does not do that. Even if he gets angry, he does not say something bad or wrong or unjust. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى. Every speech he does is revelation. Now you may ask me, how if he speaks to his wife at home, he says to her, sweetie, I love you. Is this revelation too? No, this is not revelation. We are talking about the speech that the Prophet presents to his community in his capacity as a prophet, not as a husband with his wife in privacy. Sometimes he tells his wife things, but these are not revelations. He's a husband. We say when he says something in public, in the masjid, when he gives a speech, or when he's teaching, في مقام التعليم, when he's teaching, or someone comes to him and he asks him a question and he answers him. Here, he does not do any mistake. This is revelation. The Prophet has two types of discourses. One, when he is a prophet, he speaks as a prophet, no mistake. But sometimes you may ask me, everything that he utters is revelation? No. Because sometimes he says something private to his wife at home, in bed. This is not revelation. This is a husband talking to his wife. What we are concerned about when he speaks in public, when he speaks in the capacity as the messenger of God, that's very important. He does not do mistake. Other traditions, non-Shia traditions, they believe that the Prophet could do mistake. Sometimes he forgets. Sometimes he gives wrong answers. Sometimes he has wrong assumptions. Sometimes he has doubts. Sometimes when he was praying, he made a mistake and he made a wrong. He said something wrong in his recitation, a mistake in his recitation. But we in the Shia Islam, in the tradition, the school of Ahlul-Bait, alayhim afdhalus salatu wassalam, we believe that the Prophet has immunity, protection, like diplomatic immunity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is guarding him, protecting him against error. Because if we believe that that Prophet makes mistake, can you trust him after that? It's difficult to trust him. Someone would come and argue that maybe he didn't know what he was talking about. So Allah protects him to give his speech credibility and value. So you believe in what he is telling you. Besides, the Quran says, this is a very clear-cut answer in the Holy Quran. The ayah that I'm going to recite. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, مَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ. Everything this man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says to you, take it. Take it, don't argue with him. Do not have doubt in your mind that is he speaking the truth or falsehood? Is he right or wrong? Is he know what he's talking about or not? Don't say these things. خُذُو. Take it. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ. When he says, don't do these things. فَانْتَبُوا. Don't do. Listen to him. This means that God is giving him protection, immunity, against, not only against sins, but against errors, خَطَى. He does not do mistakes. Yes, he's a human being, but when he speaks, he knows what he's talking about because this is the direction and the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So some of the Sahaba also, they said, Ya Rasulullah, إِنَّا نَسْمَعُ مِنْكَ أَشْيَاءً فَنَكْتُبُهَا. We hear things from you. Immediately, everything you say, we put it down. We write it down. فَنَكْتُبُهَا. Is there something wrong with that? The answer of the Prophet ﷺ was, أُكْتُبُوا وَلَا حَرَجْ. Write down everything I tell you. And don't worry. وَلَا حَرَجْ means, don't worry. There is nothing wrong in that. I'm not going to say something wrong, so don't worry. Everything I'm telling you is right. Uktubu wala haraj. But unfortunately, there was a very bitter incident that took place 3 days before the departure of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was on deathbed, and he said, "Ituni bidawatin wa qirtas." Bring me pen and paper, so I write a directive. لِأَكْتُبَ لَكُمْ كِتَابًا لَن تَضِلُّوا بَعْدِي أَبَدًا. This book, if you hold fast to this directive, to this will, to this wasiyya that I'm giving you, to this advice, you would never be misguided in your life. One of them did not like what the Prophet was going to write, and he said this very famous quotation 1400 years ago. While the Prophet was still alive, 3 days before his death, he said, "Hasbuna kitabullah." Enough for us, this book. This book suffices us. We don't need what Muhammad is telling us. Hasbuna kitabullah. Has means enough. Enough for me, this book. I don't need the sayings, the hadith of the Prophet. And this sentence reverberated among some circles of the Sahaba, and they kept saying this until today. Until today, we have people in our communities, Muslim communities, who says we don't need the hadith, Quran is enough for us. But that's not right. That's not right. Why it's not right? Why do we need the hadith? Do we really need the hadith? Yes, we do. Where is it in the Quran? The Quran says to the Prophet, in Surah Al-Nahl, the B, verse 44. وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. We have sent down this book. Dhikr, this is dhikr. One of the names of this book is dhikr. Why it is dhikr? What's the meaning of dhikr? Dhikr, to remind. To remind. This book is a reminder. Allah says, when you were born, you know about all the good things. I installed a chip, you know, inside you, that you know all the good things and the bad things. However, sometimes you forget. Allah put here a software. When you were born, each and every newborn was installed with a software to teach him the good and the bad. But then why people do bad things? Is the software corrupt? No, it's not corrupt. It's not corrupt. Because they forget. They forget. We do forget. So Allah says, we sent the book to remind you, dhikr. وَمَا هُوَ إِلَّا ذِكْرٌ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. A reminder. So Allah says to the Prophet, وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرِ. We send this upon you. Why? Just to read it and memorize it? No. لِتُبَيِّن. To translate for people what God wants from them. Now, if this book was enough, why should we have a prophet? Let me ask you, some of you, my friends, tell me. God has sent the book. Why do we need a Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Why do you need him? Translator. Huh? Translator. Ahsant. Prophet Muhammad is the one who does tabeen, elucidation, tawdih, explanation, tafsir, translation, interpretation of this book. So we need him. How does he do that? Through hadith. Therefore, both the wording of the Quran and the wording of the Prophet are sacred, both. Yes. Both are sacred. And they both come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even the hadith comes from Allah. But on the tongue of the Prophet, through the Prophet. The Prophet is the vehicle that he carries, the wahi. So the hadith is not less sacred than this book. It's not less sacred. Hadith is also the wording of Allah, but it goes indirectly to you through the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore, we need the hadith. And many ulama, they say, Quran without hadith does not work. Not only Shia scholars, even Sunni scholars. One of them is Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, one of the polemic scholars. Polemic means he was anti-Shia. Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi was one of the anti-Shia scholars. In his book, Al-Ihkamu fi Usul al-Ahkam, he has a book. He says, لو أن امرئا قال, if a person says, this is Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, لو أن امرئا قال, a person says, لا نأخذ إلا ما وجدنا في القرآن لكان كافرا بإجماع الأمة. I don't accept anything except what is here in this book, then that person is a non-Muslim because he's rejecting the hadith, and the hadith is part and parcel, one of the fundamentals of aqidah. He's rejecting the hadith. Therefore, he's not a Muslim. This is Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi. And notice, he says, لَكَانَ كَافِرًا. He's kafir. So that those guys, they started the business of takfir. Takfir. Easy for them to say, a person is kafir. One of the people who put the foundations of takfir today, excommunicating the Muslims from Islam, was him and Ibn Taymiyyah. Those who started this business, unfortunately, business of takfir, as soon as you disagree with him, kafir, kafir. Which led into the emergence of ISIS today. Very easy for them to say to the people, you are kafir. You know what they did recently in Mosul? In Mosul, they are dominating the city and having the Islamic caliphate in Mosul. Children who are not baligh yet, children at the age of 8, 10, if they don't fast, they're going to persecute them. Children who do not fast, so don't go to Mosul now during the month of Ramadan. Yeah. They say every person has to fast, including little children. Yeah. But one good thing they did, out of 10 million bad things they did, one good thing they did, in Mosul, they said, no Salatu Taraweeh. Salatu Taraweeh is bid'ah, innovation. The Prophet did not do Taraweeh, so there is no Taraweeh. This is a true one. This is a true. That's the only good thing they did. One out of 10 billion things that they did wrong, one of them was right, because Salatu Taraweeh is not the sunnah of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So let me ask you, I want to ask you and pay attention to this. In what verse in the Quran, in what surah, what chapter in the Quran, Allah says the noon prayers is 4 raka'at? What chapter in the Quran? Think about it.
No, sir. No, it's not there.
Where is it then?
The Prophet said.
It's in the Hadith. Nowhere in the Quran. Allah says, أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ, establish the prayers. أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ لِدُلُوكِ الشَّمْسِ إِلَىٰ غَسَقِ اللَّيْلِ وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ. But nowhere he says morning prayers are 2, noon 4, afternoon 4, maghrib 3, isha. Nowhere. This is in the sunnah of the Prophet. This is why we need the sunnah, we need the Prophet. Otherwise, if you say, I don't need the sunnah, then how many rak'ah are you going to do the dhuhr? How many? And if you do it for, why do you do it for? Because you say, I don't accept the Prophet. I don't accept what he says. His hadith, I don't need it. Then why don't you do it too? Make it easy for you. Where is it in the Quran that we have the details of the Hajj? Nowhere in the Quran. Which verse in the Quran says you have to do tawaf 7 rounds? Or sa'i 7 rounds? Nowhere in the Quran. Quran speaks about tawaf, speaks about sa'i, but does not prescribe the number of the rounds that you do. Where is it in the Quran that this much you have to pay zakat? Where is it? It's all the hadith. Hadith goes into the details. Where are the rules of family and marriage and divorce in the Quran? Quran speaks in very vague terms, just headlines. It does not give details. The details are given by the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you know that? How many do you think hukm we have? Religious injunction, hukm, shari'i. How many do you have? How many do we have? Can you give me a figure? Things that are halal and haram, these things you can do, these things regarding ibadat, all the ibadat, beginning with tahara, with prayers, with fasting, with hajj, with zakat, and then after that, bay', shira, business transactions, then marriage, divorce, family, inheritance, this and that. How many hukm we have? If you collect them, put them together, how many pieces we have? How many articles of law we have, Islamic law? How many? How many do you think?
880.
How many do we have in general?
200.
In general? Over 50,000. If you put them together, these articles, they are over 50,000. How many of these 50,000 are found in the Quran? How many hukm are found in the Quran? How many halal and haram in this book? Huh? 350. Just 350. 350 hukm shari'i, religious injunction, are found. So where are the rest? Where they come from? From the hadith. 350 are not enough for me to show me the way. So they are from the hadith. And the Prophet ﷺ is the one who depends on the Quran, on the revelation, the wahi, to explain what is halal and what is haram for me, to explain the Islamic sharia for me. So this is important that we have hadith. Now, some people say, the reason we say we don't want hadith, because of fabrication. It is true. Yes. Unfortunately, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ has been fabricated and falsified and altered from day one. From day one. And the reason for that, when it comes to this book, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. We brought this book down. We're going to maintain and protect and shield this book against any corruption. No one can corrupt this book. They tried. They tried over centuries, many, many, many Muslims and non-Muslims. They tried to make up some verses, put them inside this book. But you can discover them soon. They tried to edit the Quran. They would say, these verses are good, you know, Western friendly, American friendly verses. We keep them. These are, no, anti this and anti that, we have to drop them. They could not. Allah says, I safeguard this book. Allah promised, He said, I am going to protect this book from day one until the day of judgment. No person can alter or change this book. No person can even bring one single verse similar to what I have here in this book. No one. قُلَّ إِنِ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنسُ وَالْجِنِ. The entire mankind, they gathered in a convention, and the jinns supporting them to bring one verse similar to this, they would not be able to do. They would not be able to do so. However, when it comes to the hadith, unfortunately, people can fabricate the hadith. And the fabrication of hadith was a business. And I tell you how. Because immediately after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam,
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The authority at that time, the political authority after the Prophet, they banned the scription of the hadith, tadween al-hadith. Writing down the hadith was completely banned. On some pretext, but these pretexts were not a tool. What they advanced, what they said, is that we don't want the hadith to get, for people to get confused between the hadith and what? And the Quran. This is one pretext. The second excuse is that if we allow people to read, to write the hadith down and start reading it, then they're going to abandon the Quran in favor of the hadith. Abandon the Quran, why? Why people abandon the Quran? I don't understand why. Actually, if you read more hadith, you're going to get closer to the Quran. And you're going to love the Quran more and more because the hadith is about the Quran. It's about translating the Quran. There is no conflict between the hadith and the Quran. These were excuses. What do you think was the real reason for banning the hadith? Can someone tell me, other than this Hajji here? Someone else can tell me why they banned the hadith for 143 years. They did not allow people to write the hadith. They will burn the books. They will burn them. They could collect anyone who has some written hadiths. They take him. They take it from him. They burn it down. It was bad. And they said people should not congregate and discuss the hadith. They should not do that. Mamnu'. Only speak about Quran. Until 143 years, Hijri, during the time of what caliph? No. 143 years. Who said Imam Ali? Imam Ali, he was killed in 41. In year 40 Hijra. This is 100 years after Imam Ali. During what caliph? No. Even Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, who came from 99 Hijri until 101 Hijri for 2 years, he could not restore the hadith. They did not allow him. Although he was the caliph. So until what time, what caliph's time, that the hadith was okay? I know the Abbasis, but what particular caliph? Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, before Mamun. In Baghdad, Abu Ja'far al-Mansur al-Abbasi, year 143 Hijri, he said, now we really need to sit and encourage the scholars and muhaddithin, the transmitters of hadith, to write the hadith down, because we are losing the hadith. So what was the pretext? The pretext was we don't want people to get confused with the Quran. We don't want people to turn away from the Quran for the hadith. But what was Adam, the real reason? What was the real reason? The real reason was political reason. Why political? Because they did not want people to know who is the caliph after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. They did not want the Muslim Ummah to hear the numerous hadiths of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam regarding successorship, khilafah, and imamah after. They wanted people to stay away from that. Don't speak about that. That was the real reason. As a result of that, we witnessed this waves, not just one, waves of falsification and fabrication and alteration in hadith, which is called al-wad'u fil hadith. Wad'u, to lie, to bring about a hadith. As an example, I told you, an example. Imam Muslim comes after Bukhari. Imam Muslim in his book has 4,000 hadiths. Bukhari has 3,700 and something. Imam Muslim says, the hadith that I have In my book, the 4,000, I filtered them down. Filtered. I made filtration. From, you know how many hadiths he had originally? 30,000. He dropped 26,000 and he said only these 4,000 are correct. After him came Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ahmad ibn Hanbal in his Musnad, his book is called Musnad, Musnadul Imam Ahmad. In his Musnad, he has 30,000 hadith, 30,000. You know how many originally he collected and he filtered them down to 30,000? You know what was the original number? Huh? More than 60,000. More than 100. More than 300. More than 500.
1 million.
Less than million. 700,000, Ahsant Ali. You'll get a bottle of water, huh? 700,000. He collected 700,000 and then he said, all these, imagine, 670,000 are bad, false fabrications. Only these 30,000 hadith are good. Imagine when they banned description of the hadith from day one, that was the result. A business flourished. Business. That business was called al-wad'u fil hadith or wad'u al-hadith, falsification of hadith. It became like a business. Just to get it close to your mind, like today, journalism today. If you go to most Muslim countries, in particular Arab countries, the journalist has a nickname. Nickname. They don't call him Sahafi or journalist. They call him Dajjal. Dajjal, a liar. Because 99% of what he reports, what he writes, are not right. He writes only to appease the government, to support the government. Because he's on a payroll. 3 days ago, there were a leak. Did you hear about them? Saudi Arabia, they paid thousands of journalists around the world. They paid them multi-million dollars. They were on payroll. Not only journalists, politicians in Iraq. You know the Speaker of Parliament in Iraq? The head of the parliament in Iraq, not this one, the one before him, he received a check for 575 million dollars from the Saudi, the head of the Saudi intelligence. They gave him a check. 575 million dollars. More than half a billion dollars to one person. His name is Osama Nujafi. And unfortunately, now he's the vice president, ironically, still in power. The vice president of Iraq. He received this check and he was told, we want you to unsettle the government of Nur al-Maliki, kick him out of power. And this is exactly what they did. This is one example. They gave money generously, the money of the people of Saudi Arabia, the Muslimin, the Mu'mineen, the money where they supposed to build schools and hospitals and give to the Muslims and give to the Yemenis that they are bombing, they would give it to mercenaries. Many of them are journalists. These channels that you see, Jazeera, Arabia, and others, and others, and others, and others, they were on the payroll still today. They speak, they attack all regimes except the regime of Saudi Arabia. Ma'soom, alhamdulillah, ma'soomeen, infallible. They have no sin, they have no mistake. This is exactly what the policy of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, the enemies of Ahlul-Bayt. They paid money generously to some people to fabricate hadiths against Ahlul-Bayt. Two types of hadith. One type was directed to attack Ahlul-Bayt, put them down. The other type of hadith is to praise the Sahaba who were anti-Ahlul-Bayt, to praise them and get them close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was a business, flourished business. This is why we have something called ilmul hadith today. We have to filter the hadith. So at the end, I want to say, we should not say that hadith is bad, only Quran is enough for us. This is not good. Quran alone is not enough. Allah says, you need the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to explain this book for you. But on the other hand, not any hadith is acceptable. The hadith has to go through a process of filtration. Very detailed process to filter the hadith, make it pure, authentic, then we can accept it, inshallah. Allahumma akhbar bil mu'minina wal mu'minat, wal muslimina wal muslimat, al ahya'i minhum wal amwat, tabi'an lahumma baynana wa baynahum bil khayrat, innaka mujibu al-da'awat, innaka ghafiru al-khati'at, تقبل منا صلاتنا وصيامنا ودعاءنا في هذا الشهر العظيم وعجل في فرج سيدنا ومولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات رواب الفاتحة مع الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد